Okay, good afternoon. Now we will see what are the topics we have just discussed in the yesterday class for a while, just within 2 minutes, and then we will continue our today's section. So these are some of the advantages, and we have seen the modes of the transfer of your heat through conduction, convection, and radiation. So some what are the requirements we have required to choose your good heating element, so all those things, and as well as the advantages, what are going to be caused, disadvantages, that is nothing but causes of your failure. So, and we have seen the materials what we have used for your heating elements depend upon their operating temperatures. So we have seen this important topic, that is the design of your heating element, and we have done some problems upon these things. So mostly, most of all, the design is going to be calculated according to your heat dissipation that was being produced by your Stephen's law. And our next topic is the methods of electrical heating. In the previous classes, you have seen how these methods are broadly classified. So based upon your power frequency and high frequency. So this frequency, power frequency heating is being classified into three types, that is resistance heating, arc heating, and induction bombardment heating. In the high frequency heating, we are going to have induction heating, dielectric heating. Okay, in the yesterday class, we have seen what is meant by a direct resistance heating, indirect resistance heating, and infrared or radiant heating. So by learning these three things, methods, we have completed our resistance heating, that is methods which we used for under the resistance heating. So now we are going to step into the arc heating. So here are some of the methods which we have used for the wide applications. This is the direct resistance heating. So under the best examples we have seen, that is salt bath furnace and boiler, electrode boiler. So another method is indirect resistance heating. How the charge which you wants to heat it is going to be heat. Not directly, we have heated up with an indirect method, that is heating within a chamber by the electrodes. So each and every method is going to be followed that based upon your type of supply. If you have considered this DC supply or single phase AC supply, just two electrodes are sufficient to heat your charge. While when a part of that single phase and a DC supply, if you are having availability of three phase, then we are going to have one more electrode, that is we are placing three electrodes to heat up your charge. So this is one of the best example, resistance wovens. We have considered how this resistance woven has been taken, and between the furnace we have operated between the temperatures ranges, that is up to 1500 1050 degrees centigrade and 1350 degrees centigrade. That's based upon your temperature furnace. If you are going to use the medium temperature furnace, then you are going to employ the temperature at around 300 degrees centigrade to 1050 degrees centigrade. If you want to heat up, or that is nothing that for hardening the materials or metals, for that we need very high operating temperature. So that is considered as high temperature furnaces, which are about 1050 degrees centigrade and 1350 degrees centigrade. So this is the some of the best example we have considered. And what are the losses we have going to face while you are considering this wovens, and how much of the efficiency is going to be acquired while using this wovens for the particular applications. That is about 60 to 80%. We have developed one equations regarding upon your heat calculations. So this is the equation you have seen in the yesterday class. So there is only one example, that is nothing but a problem. So based upon this, I will just give you the problem and solution. You can easily understand that. Just placing the values from the given data and into the problem. Okay, so this is another third method under the resistance heating. There is infrared, there is nothing but radiant heating. So here the name indicates that heating of your material is going to be done with a radiation. We are not going to do any, in this method, we are not going to apply any electrodes directly or indirectly to heat up your required charge. So these are the some, this is the one, another method, best method. So here we have used tungsten filament lamp. Why we have used here, I have explained that because the operating temperature point is about 2300 degrees centigrade to 3000 degrees centigrade to a greater portion. So, and also which is having in a longer life period. So this is in a one pictorial representation how your radiation is going to be takes place oppositely to the convection, absorption and conduction processes. These are nothing but the modes of transform of your heat energy. These are nothing but your the transfer of heat to charge, to heat your charge. That is either by radiation or convection, absorption and conduction. So this is the one best basic thing. This represents is nothing but the basic thing to represent your infrared method of heating. So how the walls are going to be heated, and from that walls how you are going to feel that heat, and you are going to absorb that heat from the walls itself. I have shown you another figure also, and also the appliances, type of appliances what we have used in this radiant heating. Okay, so this is the process how these radiation are going to be applied in this room. So there is nothing but any heater. We can call it as a heater. So while switching on the heater, we are going to feel that hot air, the hotness. So from that hotness, we are going to keep the room temperature below the required temperature. Sorry, we are going to keep the required temperature below the room temperature. So that's why you are going to feel very warm when compared to the room temperature by using this heating applications. Okay, there are the some of the controllers. So we have to choose how the process of controlling is going to be done. There here we have used this three methods, that is changing the resistance of the heating elements and changing the applied voltage of the heating elements or the current passing through the heating elements. And we also the same thing, changing the ratio of on and off times of your supply. So these three are very important steps to be followed while you are choose to control your temperature of your resistance heating. So first of all, before taking into the consideration of these steps, we have to keep in remind, we have to keep in your mind that you have to remind that every heat, whatever the heat you are going to develop by your heating elements are done by the losses. Done by the losses, that is nothing but your power loss. That is the thing we are learning up from the first class of this unit. This is depends upon your I square R, that is nothing but your power loss. So here by changing the resistance of the elements, that is series or parallel, you are going to connect in the series resistance. We are going to get the small amount of heat, that is temperature. While connecting in the parallel, we are going to get the high temperatures. So this one, when coming to the second point, for changing the applied voltage, how we are going to change this voltage? Just by employing the tap changing transformer. By changing the tappings of your transformer, the voltage is going to be controlled. By controlling the voltage of your elements, then the temperature is going to be controlled. And also I have explained this changing of ratio of on and times. So based upon the on time and off time, the temperature is going to be produced, that is either increment or decrement based upon your supply and the time. Okay, so here we have seen some of equations and how this one. So series parallel or star delta arrangements of your elements. Okay, so if you have considered the single phase, just we are going to connect the our elements in series and parallel. So if you required for the low temperatures, you are going to connect it in series. For the high temperatures requirement, we are going to connect in parallel. So that's why this is called as a series parallel switch. The name indicates the series parallel switch. Now coming to the star delta, if you connected like this, just all you know that star and delta. So here we required three phase supply. So when you are connecting the three phase supply instead of single phase supply, the elements are going to be connected in star and delta form. So here also same terminology. That is nothing but for low temperature requirements, you are going to connect it in star form. In the star form, that is nothing but the elements are going to be connected star. Suppose if you want to operate these heating elements at the high temperature, then what we are going to do? Just connecting the elements in the delta shape. So that's why it is also known as star delta switch. Okay. So up to this, we have seen the resistance heating methods. So how this resistance heating is going to be employed, either directly or indirectly or by radiant heating, and some of the controlling steps we have seen. So your next heating method under your power frequency heating is nothing but arc heating. In this also, you are going to see how this arc is going to be produced. By that arc, how you are going to heat your charge or the material or the substance. Okay. So here also you are going to be, this arc heating has been classified into two types, that is direct arc heating and indirect arc heating. Oh, okay, we will see in the next slides. So first of all, I would like to ask you, so what is an arc? How it is going to be produced? So first of all, you have to know how this arc is going to be produced. So for simply, here also I'm going to take two electrodes. So for these two electrodes, I'm going to supply very high voltage. Then what is going to be happen? If I produce high voltage to this heating material, that is an electrodes. So here, whatever the gap between these two, we are going to have some air. The air is going to be present in this thing. Whenever this high voltage applied to these electrodes or the heating elements, the air is going to get ionized. How this air is going to get ionized? This is my question. Okay, when you apply the high voltage, the air gap, whatever this gap is called as an air gap, the gap between these two electrodes is nothing but an air gap. In this air gap, the air gets ionized. How this air is going to be ionized? So anyone? Okay, 253 raise your hands. Yes, you can unmute yourself from.
ఎయిర్ కి ఉన్న రెసిస్టివిటీని గనక బ్రేక్ చేసేంత కరెంట్ గనక ఫ్లో అయితే అక్కడ ఎయిర్ అంతా అయనైజ్ అయ్యిద్ది సార్.
ఓకే,
సో ఆ టైం లో
చెప్పండి చెప్పండి
ఆ టైం లోనే ఒక కండక్టర్ నుంచి ఇంకో కండక్టర్ కి ఒక ఆర్క్ ఒక మీడియం లాగా వెళ్తది సార్, అది అదే ఆర్క్ గా ప్రొడ్యూస్ అయ్యిద్ది సార్.
Yes, right, right. Okay, సో ఇక్కడ ఎగ్జాక్ట్లీ వాట్ ఐ వుడ్ లైక్ టు సే ఇస్ సార్, వాట్ యు సెడ్ ఇస్ వెరీ రైట్, ఇస్ కరెక్ట్. సో how this air is going to be ionized means due to the electrostatic forces, due to the electrostatic forces, that effect is going to be done here itself in this air gap. Due to that action, this air is going to be this air gap, whatever it is going to be present here, is going to be acts as a conducting medium. Is going to be conducting medium. So the electric current, whatever we produce, is going to be passed as an arc. That is nothing but we can say spark. It's produced like in a spark. This spark is nothing but your arc. ఒక్కొక్కసారి మీరు చూడండి, రెండు కండక్టర్స్ని తీసుకుని జస్ట్ మీరు రెండింటిని రబ్ చేస్తే, అంటే జస్ట్ ఒకసారి టచ్ చేస్తే మనకు ఒక చిన్న స్పార్క్ లాగా వస్తుంది. దట్ ఈస్ నథింగ్ బట్ ఎన్ ఆర్క్. సో ద సేమ్ థింగ్ సేమ్ మెకానిజం వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు యూస్ టు ఫర్ ప్రొడ్యూస్ యువర్ ఆర్క్. సో హియర్ వన్ థింగ్ ఈస్ సో ఫనీ, దట్ ఈస్ థింగ్ here you are going to produce very high voltage to produce the arc, but there is no any need of having that high voltage to maintain that arc. Adhvaina ippudu manam oka arc ni produce cheyali ani ante maniki ento high voltage kavali. ఆ హై వోల్టేజ్ ప్రొడ్యూస్ చేయడం వల్ల ఆ కండక్టర్స్ మధ్య ఉన్న ఎయిర్ ఏదైతే ఉందో, ఆ గ్యాప్లో ఉన్న ఎయిర్ అయోనైజ్ అయ్యి మనకి స్పార్క్ కింద ప్రొడ్యూస్ అవుతుంది ఆ ఎలక్ట్రిక్ కరెంట్. అంటే ఆ మధ్య రెండింటిని కండక్టింగ్ మీడియం కింద యాక్ట్ అవుతుంది. సో ఆ కండక్టింగ్ మీడియంలో ఎప్పుడైతే కరెంట్ పాస్ అవుతుందో, ఆ పాస్ అయ్యే కరెంటు మనకి స్పార్క్ లాగా కనిపిస్తుంది. దాన్నే మీరు ఆర్క్ అని మనం పిలుస్తాం. సో ఇప్పుడు ఆ ఆర్క్ ప్రొడ్యూస్ చేయాలంటే మనకి ఎంతో హ్యూజ్ అమౌంట్ ఆఫ్ హై వోల్టేజ్ అనేది ప్రొడ్యూస్ చేయాలి. సో వన్స్ ఒకసారి ఆర్క్ ప్రొడ్యూస్ అయిన తర్వాత దాన్ని మెయింటైన్ చేయడానికి అంత హై వోల్టేజ్ అవసరం లేదు. విత్ లో టెంపరేచర్స్ లో వోల్టేజ్ వీ కెన్ మెయింటైన్ దట్ ఆర్క్. సో ఇక్కడ ఏంటంటే మనం ప్రొడ్యూస్ చేయడానికి హెవీ అమౌంట్ ఆఫ్ ఎనర్జీని యూజ్ చేస్తున్నాం. వన్స్ ఒకసారి అది ప్రొడ్యూస్ అయిన తర్వాత దెర్ ఈస్ నో నీడ్ ఆఫ్ హై ఎనర్జీ టు మెయింటైన్ దట్ ఆర్క్. ఓకే, సో దిస్ ఈస్ ద థింగ్ హ్యాపెన్. The same thing I have written, just like let me rub it, erase it. Okay, here the same thing I have. If the high voltage is applied across an air gap, the air in the gap gets ionized under the influence of electrostatic force. This here the effect is going to be, the action is going to be taken, then it is going to conduct as in a conducting medium. Then the current flowing in the form of a continuous spark is known as an arc. Okay, this is the same thing what I explained to you, just written it. So here one thing is the high voltage required for striking an arc adi elaaga. So ee high voltage anedi manam ee arc ni strike cheyadaniki manam elaaga use chestam. So what are the equipment we are going to use to fed this? That is nothing but you are going to use in a step up transformer. Just we are going to have the variable AC. Just as here we are using in a single phase AC. Suppose if you say for single phase AC the maximum voltage is 230 volts, but you need more than 230 volts, but you cannot change the supply. So then what we are going to do, just we are going to just place in a step up transformer. So all you are very good aware of the transformer action. So the transformer is nothing but a static piece of device which transforms one form of energy to another form of energy without changing any frequency. That is the main important thing you have to understand. It is not going to have any rotating parts. It's just a static piece of device, but it is going to transform the energy from one form to another form. That is nothing but you can vary the voltage from low level to high level and high level to low level. So by that action we are going to place here a step up transformer. Here we are going to use step up transformer, just increasing the voltage which was fed from your AC supply. Okay, here one question is, here we are going to use the two electrodes. So for each and every material, conducting material or any heating element, we should require the material. So those material here we used is కార్బన్ అండ్ గ్రాఫైట్. కార్బన్ అండ్ గ్రాఫైట్ వై వై సార్ వీ ఆర్ యూజింగ్ దిస్ కార్బన్ అండ్ గ్రాఫైట్ వీ హ్యావ్ మోర్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ అలాయ్స్ టు కన్స్ట్రక్ట్ దిస్ హీటింగ్ ఎలిమెంట్స్ ఎస్ ఆఫ్ కోర్స్ రైట్ బట్ డ్యూ టు సమ్ ప్రాపర్టీస్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ కార్బన్ అండ్ ద గ్రాఫైట్ దట్ ఈస్ నథింగ్ బట్ యువర్ కండక్టివిటీ సో ఇట్ కెన్ ప్రొడ్యూస్ ఎన్ ఎ హ్యూజ్ అమౌంట్ ఆఫ్ టెంపరేచర్ దట్ ఈస్ 3200 డిగ్రీ సెంటిగ్రేడ్ టు 3500 డిగ్రీ సెంటిగ్రేడ్ By using this material, we can operate these electrodes at 3200 degrees centigrade to 3500 degrees centigrade range. So that's why we are going to use this electrodes. So there are the sum of differences we will see in the next slide. So here, yes, one thing, this is the one method, just placing in two electrodes and we are mating in an arc. So there is another method. There is another method to produce your arc at the low voltage. Just we are first method we are saying that by providing in a high voltage we are going to produce an arc between the two electrodes by this electrostatic force action by the influencing these electrostatic forces we are going to develop an arc. But here my question is you are not going to have any high voltage. There is no any availability of your step-up transformer. You cannot change the supply. Just you are going to have only single phase supply, that is you are having in a low voltage. But your work has to be done. But the above process is not going to be done because it requires high voltage. But the availability of the voltage is low at your side. Then what we are going to do? Just there is another method. By using that low voltage also, you are going to produce an arc. That is nothing but
సార్ సార్ మైక్ మ్యూట్ లో ఉంది సార్ మీది.
ఓకే ఓకే ఫైన్ ఓకే డ్యూ టు దిస్ కనెక్టివిటీ ప్రాబ్లమ్ యు వి హావ్ జస్ట్ సైన్డ్ అవుట్ అండ్ సైన్ ఇన్ ఓకే లెట్స్ కంటిన్యూ ఫ్రమ్ దిస్ ఓకే హియర్ ద ఎలక్ట్రోడ్ ద మెటీరియల్స్ విచ్ వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు యూజ్ ఇస్ ఇన్ అ కార్బన్ అండ్ గ్రాఫైట్ సో వెన్ వీఆర్ నాట్ గోయింగ్ టు హ్యావ్ దిస్ హై వోల్టేజ్ వీఆర్ నాట్ గోయింగ్ టు హ్యావ్ ఎనీ హై వోల్టేజ్ దెన్ వాట్ వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు డూ జస్ట్ ఓన్లీ ద ప్రెసెన్స్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ లో వోల్టేజ్ Just by changing this method, that's nothing but by whatever the two electrodes you have considered here is just you are going to short circuit. Short circuiting these two electrodes and drawing them back the supply. So due to that low voltage availability, we are going to produce, we can also produce the arc by short circuiting the two electrodes. So here electrodes we are going to use in this arc furnaces. So whatever the arc is going to be produced in this furnace is known as this arc furnace. So in this arc furnace, the electrodes we are going to use is the carbon, graphite, and self-baked electrodes. You see? The whatever the arc furnace we are going to for the usage of low temperatures, medium temperatures or the high temperatures, the electrodes we are going to use is the carbon electrodes, graphite electrodes and self-baking electrodes. So when coming to the comparison, so the carbon electrodes are going to be used according to the total cost, but when comparison is made between the graphite and the carbon, graphite is going to have the more properties than the carbon. So here see, usually we are going to use the carbon and graphite electrodes because based upon their properties, here some of the properties I have mentioned here, that is this electrical conductivity and insolubility, that is the one property. And based upon the chemical inertness and based upon the mechanical strength and based upon the resistance to the thermal shock. So whenever the arc produced between the two electrodes, the furnace, the material which you used for constructing your furnace, the mechanical, it has to withstand for the mechanical vibrations which was caused during the process, and it also withstand the thermal shocks. Whenever very high voltage has been produced, the electrodes should be withstand for that high thermal efficiency, high thermal resistance. So the electrode should have the high thermal resistance. So in the practical section, that is nothing but in the commercial purposes, while these electrodes are going to have the size of 18 to 27 centimeters in this diameter, they are having an 18 to 27 centimeters in diameter. Okay, so let us see what are the requirements we are going to consider for having the carbon electrodes or graphite electrodes. Which were the best electrodes we are going to consider for the different applications? So these are the application where these are carbon electrodes. So usually in the for the small furnaces, that is manufacturing of your ferroalloys, aluminium, phosphorus, all these materials what we are used for the heating purpose, these carbon electrodes are going to be used in small for small furnaces. If instead of these small furnaces, you are going to take these electrochemical furnaces, so the chemical reactions are going to take place by the passing of the electricity. That's the, in that type of furnaces, we are going to provide this self-baking, the self-baking electrodes. Earlier, in this, we have used carbon electrodes, graphite electrodes, and self-baking electrodes. So these carbon electrodes and graphite electrodes, we have seen where we are going to be used. That is nothing but in the small furnaces. That is manufacturing of ferroalloys, aluminium, phosphorus, and other some means of alloys are there to manufacture. So in that purpose, we are going to use the carbon electrodes. But we're coming to this self-baking electrodes. These are going to be employed in your electrochemical furnaces. Okay? And in the electrolytic production of aluminium. So for these applications, we have considered the type of electrodes we have used. Here, some of the salient features. What I said earlier. So we have to consider these features while choosing your electrodes for the heating process. So the four things is the resistivity, oxidation, electrode composition, and the cost. So the major thing is first one we have to check with this resistivity. So due to the low specific resistance which was provided in the graphite than the carbon electrodes, the amount of graphite we used for the electrodes is off in size. We can, when compared to the so here the resistivity, so the main important feature we have to consider while comparison made between the graphite electrode and the carbon electrodes is the specific resistance. So when coming to the comparison, the graphite electrodes are the graphite, the material which is having the low specific resistance. When the resistance value is less, we can produce very high currents so that we can produce the arc easily. So that's why we are going to consider this graphite electrodes. And the amount of graphite which is used to make your electrode for the heating purpose, the requirement is half when compared to the carbonates. The amount of carbon which is used to made your electrodes for the heating purpose when comparatively is very high than the graphite. But when coming to the graphite side, the graphite amount of graphite we used is very less. That is nothing but half of the amount of carbon. And the second one is oxidation. So oxidation going to takes place, that is begins the graphite material begins at 600 degrees centigrade of the temperature. When the heating, the temperature of your furnace, which is less than 600 degrees centigrade, then while we are using this graphite, at that 600 degrees centigrade, the graphite is going to get oxidized. That means we have to maintain the temperature more than 600 degrees centigrade while we are using this graphite material. Whereas coming to the carbon, at 400 degrees centigrade, the carbon is going to get oxidized. So that's why we are going to choose the graphite which is having a better oxidization level at the high temperature when compared to the carbon. Okay, and third one, the most another feature we have to consider is the composition. We cannot use directly, the complete pure form of the materials. So just we need some composition to have the better functioning of the electrodes. So here some I have mentioned here, for steel melting furnaces, the composition of the carbon electrode is about 4.5 kgs of electrodes per ton. Per kg of for 100 kgs of steel, we just required 4.5 kg of amount of carbon electrodes. And when coming to the graphite electrodes, we just required 2.32 to a 6.8 kg of electrodes for 100 kgs of steel. So here also we are going to consider the same consideration, that is the per ton. But here when coming to the comparison, it requires 4.5 kg. The minimum requirement of your material of the electrode, that is graphite, is 2.3 kgs only. That is, it is about 2.2 kgs higher than the graphite material. So these three are the one side of the main features. But the another main feature among these three are the cost. So this is the one economical thing we have to consider. At the point of economical, we have to consider the cost. So we are having the good properties when compared to the graphite and carbon. But there is a one small disadvantage. Disadvantage means that's up to our holding. That's up to our holding. That's nothing but is you are applicable to hold that cost or not. If you select this graphite electrodes when compared to the carbon, the cost of the graphite is going to be double the times of your carbon. They have considered it per kg, not for the total material which you are going to use for your heating purpose. So if you for the above specification, suppose if you say, if you consider 4.5 kgs of carbon, the cost for this 4.5 kgs of electrodes, if you say some x rupees, for 2.3 kgs of electrodes of graphite, if you say the value is y. But when coming to the cost, x less than y, because the carbon is having the low cost when compared to the graphite. So the choice of the electrodes is the biggest consideration point under this total cost. So before starting the process of heating, you all will have the some idea how much amount of material is required to heating the charge. So the total amount of the material, you have to calculate the total amount of cost, total amount of the total amount of financial, the total amount of cost is required, how much total is required to have the total amount of material, heating material. So based upon that, you are going to choose the type of electrodes. Okay. we will see just this furnace. We from the starting of this class we have called we have talked about that furnaces. Based upon the arc furnaces, we has been broadly classified into two types, that is direct furnace and indirect furnace. Just I will explain briefly, just a fraction of 5 minutes we will conclude this class. So here this is the direct arc furnace and indirect arc furnace. So I am going to show this diagram. From this diagram you can easily understand, here also we are going to use only single phase AC supply or DC supply. We are not going to use any three phase supply. For single phase AC supply or DC supply, we are going to use only two electrodes. These two electrodes are going to connected for the terminals of the supply. So whenever the current passes and when we applied the voltages, so the same mechanism is going to be happen and an arc is going to be produced. This arc is going to be employed directly to the charge. So whenever the arc has been employed directly into the charge is going to be heat itself. The heat is going to be produced in the charge by itself due to this arc. So this is going to be have the process of conduction also. Okay, the mode of transfer of heat here is conduction. We can take place. So this is the process we are going to see. Whenever the two electrodes has been placed vertically onto the charge and a supply is given to the supply, or then a voltage has been produced between the two terminals of this electrodes which was connected to the supply, a voltage is going to be developed. Due to that voltage, due to the action, that is nothing but the air, the air gap between the charge and the electrode is going to get ionized. By the influence of your electrostatic forces, an arc is going to be produced. This arc is going to be produced onto the charge which you wants to be heated, is going to get heated through this charge, this arc directly employed to the charge. By that, the charge is going to get heat. So this is the process you are going to happen in the direct arc furnace. The same thing which I have this written here. So if you in this process, if you are going to use three phase supply, just you are going to place another electrode here to this three phase AC supply, RYB. Suppose if you say RYB, and here also some another arc which was produced by third electrode, which was immersed vertically between these two electrodes for the three phase supply. Okay, these are the some important features and process we have taken. So this is the same thing I have written here. You can easily understand by the reading. Okay, and for this arc furnace is indirect arc furnace. The arc furnace has been classified. Another classification of this arc furnace is indirect method. Here we are not going to produce any arc directly onto the charge to be heated. Okay, I will show the figure. From this figure you can easily understand. Okay, see, this is your furnace. In this furnace I am going to place the two electrodes horizontally, not vertically. In the previous one you are going to place this vertically, but here in this figure we are not going to place any vertical, we are just placing horizontally. So here whenever the voltage has been produced to these electrodes, the same mechanism is going to be happen. The air gap which was produced between these two electrodes are going to get ionized by the influence of your electrostatic forces. Due to those forces, an arc is going to be produced. That is nothing but the electric current is going to be passed between these two electrodes as in a conducting medium, which was produced as in a conducting medium. By that medium, the electric current is passed by a spark. That is nothing but your arc. Whenever the spark has been produced, the voltage required to maintain this spark is very low at the time of beginning. Due to that, arc, we are going to radiate that spark heat energy to the charge to be heated. So here I have mentioned here the heat transfer, how it is going. So in this direct arc, indirect arc furnace, we are not going to have the mode of transfer, that is conduction or convection. It is purely depends upon the radiation. It's purely depends upon the radiation. Simply by this figure, you can easily write by your own the process how it is going to be heated up, how the charge is going to be heat. So I am once again repeating the same thing. Whenever the voltage has been applied between these two electrodes, the air gets ionized by the influence of your electrostatic force. It is going to be act as a conducting medium. This medium, in this medium, whenever a current passes, this current is going to be produced as like in a spark. By the radiation, the heat energy is going to be transformed indirectly to the charge. We are not going to place any electrodes directly onto the charge, and we are not going to provide any arc production directly onto the charge to be heated. Just we are going to make the mode of transfer, that is nothing but radiation. Through radiation, we are going to charge the, sorry, we are going to heat the charge which you require to be heated up. Okay, this is the process we are going to make in the indirect arc furnace. And one more important thing you have to consider is, we are not going to use any three-phase supply here itself, because we cannot place any third electrode in between the these two electrodes. That's why this indirect arc furnace is going to be applicable for only the low voltage side. We are going to use for the low temperature applications. Okay, so this is the thing I have written here, the same thing. So whenever the arc furnace, the furnace usually, see here I have mentioned these furnaces are usually single phase. So and their size is also going to be limited. We cannot expand this furnace size. So that's why we are going to use the load also, then one phase load. Okay, so this type of construction where these electrodes which were placed horizontally, what I have told you, we are not going to place any electrodes in the vertically, just we are going to place only horizontally. So this type of construction is nothing but your called as rocking arc furnace. Rocking arc furnace. So the function also have been mentioned very clearly in the steps itself. Okay, the process is going to be done by the mode of transfer, that is nothing but your radiation. But also here in this, due to the rocking action, the conduction also takes place. The conduction also takes place at the electrode tips. Okay, this is the process we are going to take this for this. The main important thing and final point you have to note it down is, whatever the power we are going to supply to this furnace is going to be regulated, is going to be regulated by just adjusting the electrodes, by adjusting adjusting the electrodes. That is nothing but, we can simply say, by adjusting the length of the arc between the two electrodes, we can adjust the power input of your arc furnace. Okay, so up to this I'm going to conclude the today's class. So by these two sections, that is direct arc furnace and indirect arc furnace, we have completed the method of heating under the power frequency. So we are going in upcoming class, we are going to see our methods of heating is the high frequency. Okay, we are going to see high frequency, that is induction heating and dielectric heating. By these two topics, we are going to complete our electrical heating, and then next we will see the electrical welding. Okay, if you have any queries, please have your questions in the chat box, okay, or else in your WhatsApp group. So, okay, thank you all. Stay safe, stay home.